the process for the background was ongoing, and the White House had not received any specific papers regarding the completion of that background check.
The FBI submitted a partial report on the investigation in question in March, and then a completed background investigation in late July. That is, soon thereafter, we received requests for follow-up inquiry, and we did the follow-up and provided that information in November, and then we administratively closed the file in January. And then earlier this month, we received some additional information, and we passed that on as well.
The White House Personnel Security Office, staffed by career officials, received information last year and what they considered to be the final background investigation report in November.
Well, the White House trying to straighten out this timeline about Rob Porter, the allegations of abuse when everyone knew it here at the White House, and the timeline of events prior to his resignation last week. The Wall Street Journal, catching up with the White House Chief of Staff, asked on Monday if the White House should have handled Mr. Porter's situation any differently. Chief of Staff John Kelly said, quote, no, it was all done right. Well, the first person that Kelly fired back in July, Anthony Scaramucci, said this on Twitter: based on FBI testimony, White House Chief of Staff John Kelly almost certainly knew about credible allegations of domestic abuse against Rob Porter at least 6 months ago, then recently forced others to lie about that timeline. Inexcusable. Kelly must resign. That's where we are tonight at the White House. Let's bring in our panel. Charles Hurt, opinion editor for The Washington Times. Charles Lane, opinion writer for The Washington Post. And Olivier Knox, Yahoo News chief Washington correspondent. Olivier, you were have been dealing with this White House here on this timeline. They're trying to straighten it out. It's likely maybe we're going to hear from John Kelly, do you think, to try to...
Well, typically from White Houses in damage control, there comes a point where they sort of have to put the person in charge in the room, whether that's the chief of staff, Kelly, or the White House counsel, Don McGahn.
But not President Trump.
Probably not President Trump. You know, he doesn't sign off on individual security clearances. This is a question that falls much more under the purview of the White House Counsel's Office and the Chief of Staff. White House Counsel's Office, in past administrations, has supplemented the FBI background check by asking some very penetrating questions of people in line for senior postings. We don't know if that happened in this case.
Yeah, Charlie Hurt, when you look at what the FBI director said today, and then you hear about the focus on the White House Security Office, which was kind of the line today as opposed to Monday, what do you think, and where does this story go?
Well, to be sure, Christopher Wray today did not provide any cover to the White House on this situation. But under this presidency, I would also say that's probably the least shocking break between the FBI and this White House of the past year. But that said, you know, this debate about whether the information reached the White House or reached the personnel security office across the street, it kind of doesn't really matter. Extreme incuriousness about a situation like this is a problem in and of itself. But I think that if you read between the lines, you know, obviously the White House is going to play defense on this. But the White House, Sarah Sanders has admitted that they handled it wrong and that they wish that they had handled it better. And that's probably where we stand right now.
Chuck Lane, how much of this do you think is about long knives out for Kelly? I mean, you see these stories, Axios, Chief of Staff John Kelly's White House enemies ready to use FBI Director Chris Wray's testimony as a weapon. Wray's FBI timeline makes one thing clear: the Kelly cover-up is unraveling right before our eyes, a White House official says, of course, under the cover of, you know, anonymity.
Yes, and of course, not under the cover of anonymity. The Mooch, Scaramucci, is getting a little payback on the guy who fired him, so you have to take it in that context. Obviously, there's always been a lot of factionalism and back channeling in every White House, this one especially, and it has a particular problem, though, for John Kelly, is that he was the guy who was supposed to put an end to all of that. He was the general who was going to be the adult in the room and stabilize this White House. And for a while, he seemed to be doing that. But now that's what's so dangerous for him about this uproar over his mishandling of this Porter's terrible allegations against Porter is that he seems now, John Kelly, to be actually, either by accident or design, destabilizing the White House all over again. And so the big political selling point behind his tenure now doesn't look so strong.
Yeah, Olivia, I guess the reason it got so much attention is because the allegations are so heinous. And once those pictures came out, it changed the whole dynamic of the thing.
Yeah, I think they have three basic problems here. The first one is the underlying alleged acts. So those photos are pretty horrifying, the giant bruise on the face of one of the ex-wives. The second problem they have is this constantly shifting explanation for how they handled this whole security background check process. And the third is that it could reach other places in the White House. Jared Kushner's lawyer is on the record as saying that 12 people at Jared Kushner's level and Jared Kushner also don't have security clearances, which means that this is a problem really only in its infancy.
So let me just probe that. If Jared Kushner didn't have the security clearance and it came back from the FBI saying you couldn't get him to get the full security clearance, is that a possible reason that Rob Porter is also in this limbo and left that way, even considering these allegations?
It's possible. The challenge with Jared Kushner, and this is what his lawyer, Abby Lowell, has told multiple news outlets now, is that he's saying that the reason that his background check, we don't know where it is. We now have the sketch of the timeline for Rob Porter. We don't know where the Kushner process is at all. And his lawyer says it's because of his vast holdings, business holdings, extensive travel overseas. You know, they really dig pretty, pretty far. To get the hard pass that I have to come into the White House, they were calling friends and family in France. So they're pretty thorough on this stuff.
Hard to believe you got one. Charlie Hurt, last thing here. This hearing today was about threats, the intel chiefs. And you had Dan Coats talking about the national debt while the administration is dealing with all of this budget talk. Take a listen.
I'm concerned that our increasing fractious political process, particularly with respect to federal spending, is threatening our ability to properly defend our nation, both in the short term and especially in the long term. This situation is unsustainable, as I think we all know, and represents a dire threat to our economic and national security.
Director of National Intelligence there. We heard something similar from Mike Mullen, the former chairman of the Joint Chiefs. But this happens not in a bubble. I mean, it happens as the Trump administration is dealing with this budget and House Speaker Paul Ryan is talking about how to deal with deficits down the road. It seems to be a big deal.
It is a very big deal, and I think it's the most important thing, even though, as you point out, we have heard this before, it's the most important thing out of that hearing today. And basically what he's saying is that if we were faced with another 9/11 situation or a completely dissimilar or unrelated situation where we had to respond and go to war and spend the kind of money we spent in the Iraq war, we could not afford to do it because of that debt, let alone the idea that a lot of our adversaries, like China, own enormous amounts of our debt, and if they wanted to cripple our economy, they could do it very quickly. It is a dire, serious moral issue facing this country, and neither party seems to really be that interested in making the hard decisions to address it.